Hello, I am Bob, and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining Channel. In this two-part episode, I'm going to complete my budget 120-volt Immersion Mining Build, and I'm going to cover the cost breakdown of putting this whole system together. So with that, let's get started. But before getting into my build, I want to mention some sponsors of the channel, the first being Brains. I started using Brains products and services over a year ago when I was looking for a mining pool. The Brains pool, formerly known as Slush Pool, has been around for many years. It was one of the very first mining pools created. They've been through all of the ups and downs in Bitcoin's history and have been through many Bitcoin halving events. They also offer a cool discount when you use the Brains OS on your machines, which you really should use to increase your mining returns. Finally, Brains Pool is compatible with Stratum V2, which helps with the decentralization of the Bitcoin network. When you are choosing your mining pool, I highly recommend using the Brains Pool. Now, my next sponsor is Scott's Crypto Mining and the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp. In the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp, you'll learn everything you need to know to launch your first megawatt of Bitcoin miners in less than 3 months. The Build-A-Mine Bootcamp is taught by Scott himself, and you'll be joined by other entrepreneurs and business owners like you who want to learn how to stack more sats faster through Bitcoin mining on an industrial scale. To get in on this fantastic opportunity, just click the link in the description below. And last up is a brand new sponsor of the channel, Altair Bitcoin Mining Solutions, which is a perfect match for home mining. Altair is your one-stop shop for any mining hardware you might need. They have everything from the latest and greatest miners to every hashboard, cable, and part you might need to repair your existing hardware or build your own 120-volt home-built miner. Altair has years of experience working in the Bitcoin mining industry, including running their own Bitcoin farm, and they've worked with all different scales of mining operations. Altair is based in the U.S. and has top-rated customer support. And so if you have any question about anything at any time, they are there to help you out. Altair is a huge supporter of the home mining community, so if you're looking to buy your next miner or miner parts for your home setup, check out their website at the link below. You'll find pretty much everything you'll ever need. Okay, so in the last few episodes, I've been covering the build of my budget immersion mining setup. My goal is to build a system that is cost-sensitive and can be run off of an average home electrical circuit. I started with the build of my pump and tank, and then stepped through the build of my 120-volt immersion miner. I've got the link above to the playlist if you want to catch up on those details. And with those components finished, the final steps are to build and connect a radiator, add dielectric fluid, and start everything up. Now, if I was using this system to heat my home, my hot water, or another heat use, I'd mount the tank and radiator to the floor or wall or some other permanent location next to where the heating was being used. But this is a proof of concept system, so instead, I decided to build a simple mobile framework which can be easily rolled around to where I want it. At my local home improvement store, I found some 1¼-inch aluminum angle stock. This is fairly cheap and easy to work with. I built a simple frame the width of the tank and about 4 feet long, held together with 1/4-20 bolts. I put the frame on some cheap plastic casters. The tank, radiator, and miner aren't going to weigh that much, so these casters are plenty strong to support the system. When it comes to setting the glass tank into the frame, I needed to protect the tank from any bolts or any other hard edges that might cause cracking. So I used the rubber padding that came with the tank. I cut it into strips and then used some adhesive to glue it in place on the frame. The glass tank will sit on this soft padding, and the weight of the tank with cooling fluid and miners will hold it in place. Now, as I covered in the first video of this build series, to keep the cost low, this system is going to be a simple single loop design, needing a miner tank, a pump, and a radiator. And when it comes to a radiator to dissipate the heat, there are a ton of different options here. The tank could be connected to a liquid-to-air radiator inside some ductwork, providing home heating. It could be connected to a hot water heater to preheat home water, or it could be used to heat up a hot tub or pool. I've covered all of these different uses in past episodes if you want to learn more about how each of these home uses of miner heat can work. But for this tank, I have a very unique and unusual heat use in mind. I'm still working out the detailed design, so you'll have to wait for an upcoming episode before I reveal what that is. So for now, I'm going to go with a simple radiator mounted to my mobile frame. When it came to my radiator design, I looked at two different options. The first was to use a small 12-inch square liquid-to-air radiator with an attached fan. The second was a passive design using about 8 feet of 3/4-inch diameter baseboard radiators. I went with the second option since it was a little cheaper and I wanted a silent design with no moving parts. I added some more framework to support the radiator, and this will place the heating elements at the same height as the top of the tank, which will help minimize fluid flow resistance. Now, soldering copper pipe might seem a little intimidating, but it's actually pretty simple. The pipe is cut to the right length. Both the pipe and the fittings are cleaned with a Scotch-Brite pad or emery cloth. Soldering flux is applied to the pipe and to the fittings. Everything is assembled, and then a torch is used to heat the fittings hot enough to melt the solder into the joint, and the fitting is then cleaned up with Scotch-Brite after it cools down. There's a ton of soldering how-to videos out there where top-notch plumbers can give you additional details. Search and you can easily find more information if you need it. I arranged the 2 4-foot lengths of heating elements into a serpentine design and added a PEX fitting to both ends. After setting the radiator in place using some zip ties, I attached it to the inlets and outlets of the tank with some PEX tubing. PEX is easy and cheap to work with. You just cut it to length and use clamps and a crimping tool to seal the joints. In my build, I used red and blue tubing just to make it really clear how the hot and cold fluid flow through the system. With the system complete, the next steps are to add the miner, cooling fluid, and start everything up. Now, when it comes to the cooling fluid to use in a budget immersion system, it might be tempted to try a cheaper fluid like mineral oil. However, as I've covered in a previous episode, this is a really bad idea. Mineral oil is a generic name for a bunch of different types of oils, ranging from mineral oil used by fire-breathing performers to mineral oil used as a laxative for livestock. Most of these oils have not been tested with Bitcoin mining hardware, and most will degrade electronic components over time, destroying your miner. And so here is where paying a little extra and using the correct fluid is the safe thing to do. Now, when it comes to immersion fluids that do work with miners, there are a number of different options out there, but most of these can only be purchased in bulk amounts used by industrial-sized mining setups. For a home-sized system, there really are only two options for fluids you can easily buy in smaller amounts. The first of these is ThermoSafe R made by DCX. I currently use ThermoSafe R in my DCX Bitpod system, which heats my house. It's a fantastic fluid which works great for immersion systems, and you can buy it in 22-liter containers. The second option is Bitcool made by Engineered Fluids. This is another great immersion fluid, and you can buy it in easy-to-handle 5-gallon buckets. Now, the fish tank I chose as the base for this budget design is a 10-gallon tank. And since the tank is not filled all the way up to the top of the tank, and the miner inside the tank takes up considerable room, 2 containers of either fluid is the perfect amount for this system. There's enough to fill up both the tank and the radiator. I didn't have to buy a 3rd expensive container of fluid. Now, for this budget system, although both fluids would have worked great, I'll be using Bitcool. I chose this because at the time of this video, it's a little cheaper here in the US, but mostly I chose it because I had a couple buckets left over from my prior system build. After setting the miner in place in the tank, I routed electrical lines for both the pump and miner power. I then pumped my dielectric fluid into my tank. As I noted in previous episodes, a drill pump is really handy here to reduce oil splashing and keeping things from getting messy. I filled the main compartment up to the top and the hot coolant recovery section only halfway up. Once filled, the next step is to turn on the pump. This will force air out of the radiator and will also remove all of the small bubbles from the fluid. Now, after the initial bubbles stop forming, it is also a good idea to stop and restart the pump. This can often dislodge air pockets and force them through the lines. I left the pump running for several minutes until all bubbles were gone and the fluid was crystal clear. At that point, I turned on my miner. Now, in my next video, I'm going to cover the initial system startup and a bunch of troubleshooting I had to do to get everything working. So hit that subscribe button so you don't miss out. But for the remainder of this video, I want to focus on cost. My goal with this system was a budget build, so let's see how everything stacked up. And the first part I want to look at is my home-built 120-volt miner. Now, there really aren't any new commercial 120-volt systems sold by any major miner manufacturer, so it's really hard to make any type of comparison here, but here's the cost breakdown. The most significant cost, of course, is the hashboard. After that, there's the chassis, control board, and power supply. Add in a bunch of odds and ends, and I get the total cost of my miner at a little over $900. Now, a full-size S19K Pro running on 240-volt power will run around $1,900. So this is one-third of the hash power at one-half of the price, which isn't a great trade. But if you're looking at a 120-volt miner, it's likely because you live in an apartment, or you want to heat a faraway part of your house, or you have some other limitation where high current 240-volt power just isn't available. In this case, spending a little more on hardware to get some mining done may be justified. And with that in mind, there are a few things you can do to bring down the cost even more. First, as I noted in the last episode, I went with a S19K Pro for my hashboard. It's fairly new, it has higher performance, and it's a little more expensive. If an older, less efficient hashboard was used instead, that cost could be reduced by as much as 50%, but that would affect miner performance. So you'd have to do some analysis to balance your cost and your performance. Also, although I recommend buying hardware from reputable dealers, such as the sponsor of this episode, Altair Bitcoin Mining Solutions, you could buy hardware off of eBay or other peer-to-peer websites where you might get a great deal on some of these components. But be warned, there's some risk here in that you don't have a solid company standing behind what you are buying. The other part of my budget immersion system to look at is the tank, the pump, and the radiator. And here there is a good commercially available system for comparison, and that is the Fog Hashing C1 mining system. It's a single miner tank and dry cooler system, and when the immersion fluid and shipping costs are all thrown in, they are currently going for about $1,700. So let's see how my build stacks up. The main costs of my system are the pump, the fluid, the tank, the radiator, and the aluminum framework. This gives an initial cost of a little under $1,100, which is a fair start, but then there's other costs to consider. As I put everything together, there's a ton of piping, fittings, and other odds and ends, and these add up. The total cost of my system, when everything is included, came to a little over $1,300, which isn't horrible, but it's not as cheap as I was hoping. Now, there are a couple avenues to cut the cost further. If I built the tank in place somewhere more permanent, the framework cost could go completely away. Also, I could have redesigned the copper and PEX tubing to use less fittings, which also would help. Finally, as noted in the tank build episode, my largest cost is my industrial grade pump. It's been working great, and I'm really confident that it will run for a long time, but you can buy an equivalent lower grade pump for under $100. It might work, which would bring the cost down quite a bit more, and so it might be possible to build a budget single miner immersion system for as low as $900. But that brings up one last thought, which is system reliability. When you design and build your own hardware, you're on your own. I tried to design a solid, reliable system, but as you'll see in the next episode, it doesn't always go smoothly, and you'll have to troubleshoot and fix your own problems. In contrast, a commercial system is kind of guaranteed to work. All the parts are designed to work together, and if something breaks, there's usually a warranty to help out. It might be worth the extra cost to buy a C1 or other commercial option if you're looking for something quick and reliable. And with that, this brings this episode to a close. Please hit that like and subscribe button if you haven't already. And with that, bye.